Good morning. Welcome to the symposium on the sovereignty dispute on the Falkland Islands. And I'm very happy that you all came, and I see some familiar faces, but I see also new faces, so very much welcome to this. I congratulate Fabian and the Center for having organized it. I think to some extent it's a very topical issue because it is still very much under discussion. And my name is Hildegard Schneider, I'm Dean of the faculty, and when I studied law, or even in my school days, and when I read it again, that it is, I didn't study 50 years ago, I must admit, but in my school days, it was already a discussed conflict, and it is still a discussed conflict, and no solutions are brought, and then you think, my goodness, time flies, because I had expected that the conflict would have been solved long ago. So I'm very pleased that we might contribute with this symposium, perhaps to some parts of the solutions. And if, as you just told me, there are rediscussions, and I'm also very happy that, now I'm looking, a representative of the Argentinian embassy is present, that there are some movements going on. So I'm very happy, perhaps, that we can contribute to this. And I already proposed that we will, perhaps, and I know Case has a lot of experience in this, prepare this at the end of the afternoon or tomorrow, something like the Maastricht solutions or for the conflict. So that's my proposal already, so I hope you will think about it. What I also would what I really liked when I saw the conference and the different themes, of course, it is very nice to have eminent speakers who specially come to here, so I also welcome them, but that there is also the possibility for having the awards of a prize on an essay competition. And I think that is really very, very nice to have this possibility that young scholars also can contribute to this discussion. So I only can say, and I will give the floor to Fabian, because he, as a coordinator of this program, will introduce you more in the content of the symposium. But I wish you all the best, and I'm very much looking forward to the Maastricht solutions. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Mrs. Thiel. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this symposium on the sovereignty disputes over the Falklands, Malvinas Islands. As some of you already know, my name is Fabian Raimondo, and I am the organizer of this symposium. I just would like to make a very quick introduction to the topic of this seminar. And I would like to recall that last December marked the 50th anniversary of the adoption of Resolution 2625 by the UN General Assembly. And this was the very first Assembly's resolution addressing specifically the question of the Falklands, Malvinas. By this resolution, the Assembly acknowledged the existence of a dispute over the islands between the UK and Argentina and recommended both states to negotiate the settlement of the dispute. Now, the interesting thing is that despite that recommendation, there have been no sovereignty talks for about 43 years now. And as a result of this very long deadlock, the dispute not only remains unsettled, but also transformed into a larger political conflict, which was aggravated by an armed conflict between both states in 1982, also by the unilateral exploitation of the natural resources of the islands by the UK, among other reasons. Against this background, my motivation for organizing this symposium was to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the adoption of Resolution 2625, and in so doing, to promote a better understanding of the scope of the conflict, as well as to promote the peaceful settlement of this dispute. A dispute which is very, very old. I can tell you that is almost 180 years old. Now, there is something very interesting, and that is that only 3 weeks ago, both states, Argentina and the UK, issued a so-called joint communique regarding their bilateral and multilateral relations in general, but including their relations in the South Atlantic, where the islands are located. And by this joint communique, both states showed their willingness to set up a dialogue to cooperate on South Atlantic issues of their mutual interest. They agreed to remove the obstacles to the sustainable development of the islands. On another note, I just would like to seize this opportunity to acknowledge the very generous funding from the Science Fund of the Law Faculty and from University Fund Limburg to organize this symposium, because without them, the organization of this symposium would have been very difficult. That is all what I wanted to say. I think it is time to get started. So I invite Professor Flinterman to convene the first panel. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fabian. Well, ladies and gentlemen, let's get started. Indeed, I'm very happy myself, very fortunate. I feel very privileged that I've been asked to moderate the first panel in this seminar. The first panel, which will be devoted to discussing in depth various titles to sovereignty, various competing titles to sovereignty. And we will do that after two presentations. And I would like to introduce the first speaker, and that is our colleague, Jurie Bidmar, who is a professor of public international law here at Maastricht University. And you may know that prior to his coming over to Maastricht, he held several teaching and research appointments at the University of Oxford. He was also a fellow in the human rights program at Harvard Law School. And before starting to teach here at Maastricht University, he has been teaching at the universities of Amsterdam, Nottingham, and Pretoria. As we all know, he has also published widely in the field of international law. I would in particular like to refer to his book of 2014 entitled Democratic Statehood.
Thank you, Professor Flinterman. And I would also like to thank Dr. Raimondo, Fabian, for organizing this event, as well as for to Dean Schneider for her welcoming address, and to everyone, of course, who made it here today. We are essentially talking about a dispute over the islands in Southern Atlantic. The Falklands Islands in English, or Islas Malvinas in Spanish, in plural in both languages. This is in fact an archipelago comprised of two bigger islands and of over 700 smaller ones. The population of the territory is around 3,000 people, who are primarily of British descent. The islands were, quite interestingly, and which makes it perhaps more different from other self-determination claims, they were uninhabited prior to the arrival of Europeans. They are now an overseas British territory and have been governed by Britain since the first half of the 19th century. But Argentina never relinquished its claim. Argentina's claim is that that the islands were a part of, were under Spanish sovereignty in the moment of Argentine Declaration of Independence in 1816. And although the islands were governed by Britain since 1833, Argentina never relinquished the original claim. What is more, the Britain refers to a recent referendum in which showed that the islanders overwhelmingly prefer to stay under British sovereignty. And Britain, or the United Kingdom now, refers to the principle of self-determination and that the islands cannot be transferred back against express wishes of the population. On the other hand, it is questionable, and this is what also Argentina raises, whether or not the islanders actually constitute a people for the purposes of self-determination. Let me also mention that the distance between Port Stanley, the capital of the islands, and Buenos Aires is around 1,900 kilometers. The distance to London is about 12,500 kilometers. So what we have at stake is a complicated nexus of law and politics on the question of territorial entitlement, colonialism, self-determination, and even use of force. But I will mainly focus on the right of self-determination here. And let me just draw a brief overview of this right. It is, self-determination is a collective human right. It applies to peoples. References to self-determination appear in UN Charter. The right is codified in a common Article 1 of the Covenant, so ICCPR and the ICESCR, and it also has a status of customary international law. But with regard to the Falklands, Malvinas, several difficulties now arise. First of all, as I already mentioned, do the Falklanders constitute a people for the purpose of the right of self-determination? Are they entitled to self-determination? Secondly, the right of self-determination was codified only after the end of World War II. It was arguably a political principle in the interwar period, advanced mainly or predominantly, at least in theory, by then US President Woodrow Wilson, who before he was a president, he was a professor of political science. But the Falklands dispute, of course, predates the codification of the right of self-determination. It has been a positive right of international law only since the end of World War II, and so it is debatable whether or not it was customary shortly after the war, or did it become codified only with the adoption of the two covenants. But prior to that, it was not a positive right of public international law. And as Fabian mentioned earlier, the dispute is already about 180 years old. And thirdly, does it matter in the end whether or not the Falklanders are a separate people and entitled for self-determination? Would it be acceptable, even do we actually need to get into a definition of a people? Can we just ask, would it be acceptable in contemporary international law to transfer the territory of the territory to another sovereign power, and doing so explicitly against the wishes of the people populating that territory? Or maybe if I omit the word people, in explicitly against the wishes of the population of the territory. Well, our intuition may be telling us that the answer should be no. This should not be acceptable. But then we need to know also that international law imposes severe restrictions on democratic decision making, on the will of the people. And imagine if this restrictions did not exist. So then fragmentation of states could happen. So there would be secession and then secession from secession and secession from secession from secession again. What is more, territories could be easily conquered by resettlement policies. We may say, well, there should will of the people should be respected, but we need to consider what the limitations on this will of the people are. And to look at some other practice, didn't the UK actually return Hong Kong to China, and the population of Hong Kong was never properly consulted? Now to draw a bit bigger picture, migration has always been a part of humanity, a part of our civilization. Europe is no exception. And it was then also Europeans who established their colonies in a so-called New World. Now think of Argentina and Chile, Argentina and Brazil, for example, or Zambia and Zimbabwe. Look at the map of Namibia, and you will see its odd shape, the Caprivi Strip, named after German Chancellor Leo von Caprivi, who negotiated it in 1890 with the British, that German Southwest Africa would have access to the Zambezi River and to Victoria Falls. Now, if you are from that strip, you're Namibian. If you're just a little bit north of it, you're Angolan or Zambian. If you're from the south of it, you're Botswana. And a bit southeast of it, you may be Zimbabwean. Your life in Southern Africa and your national identity may still be importantly determined by something that a German chancellor negotiated with the British some 125 years ago. What sense does this make, and why my excursion into Africa? Well, to illustrate how unfair and unjust boundaries may be, how artificially and indeed how recently, even forcefully, national identities may have been created. Not only where former overseas European possessions are concerned, also in Europe. Argentina declared independence from Spain in 1816, and the War of Independence, I believe, was won in 1818. And look at the map of Europe from 1816. Quite different than today. Just Google it and compare how boundaries in Europe have changed in the past 200 years. Now, when one is making territorial claims on the basis of historic entitlements, the first question is, how far back in history you go? Where do you set your critical date? And who should determine the critical date? And another problem is, if you're trying to eradicate a historic injustice, you may well create some new injustice. We may say that the Falklanders are settlers, but then Argentina is also a country created by settlers, and so is the United States, Canada, Australia, to give a few examples. What is a just solution? That European settlers go back to where they came from? And where should they go? Large parts of New York and Connecticut, for example, were settled by Dutch settlers. And as we now accept that colonialism was terribly wrong, is it now just if New Yorkers come back here? And I doubt there would be anything just in this solution, regardless of how unjust colonialism was in the first place. And look at Africa. European settlers caused lots of harm on that continent, but many of the present Africans of European origin have been there for generations and have no place where they could return to in Europe. But the paradox is that if we go back in history even further, if we set our critical date back back enough, say some 60,000 years, we all need to go back to Africa anyway. We are all settlers, only if we move our critical date back enough. So when we have territorial claims, we therefore need to set a critical date, but who decides? Those claiming them will usually try to present them in absolute terms. I have the right to the freedom of speech, therefore I can say whatever I want, however offensive, false, or misleading my statements may be. Well, not quite true, but you will hear people saying this over and over again. Ask the Catalans these days, among others, and perhaps at least some people across the border in Flanders, what the right of self-determination is. Independence, they will probably say. But ask the Spanish government what it thinks about Catalan self-determination, and they will most probably refer to territorial integrity of states and interpret that as an absolute entitlement of states. The reality is that your rights, individual or collective, clash with rights of others, rights of other groups and individuals. A legal system is then exactly that, a system, and a system needs balancing. Just like, for example, human body is a system which should be kept in balance. So if for example, if doctors gave you medication to cure one organ, but that medication would kill another organ, I don't think that that cure would have been successful. And international law is also a system that needs balancing. Much of it is a balancing exercise. I have already mentioned Woodrow Wilson, who had many nice and somewhat utopian ideas about national self-determination. But after World War I, he soon realized that the practical application of these ideas led to severe problems. How do you determine a self-determination unit? How do you determine a people? What do you do with mixed areas populated by people with different identities? How do you distinguish between peoples and minorities? At what point in time are settlers no longer settlers, but a people? In 1970, another great American thinker, and at the time, judge of the ICJ, Harvey Dillard, famously wrote in his separate opinion in the Namibia advisory opinion that it was not for the territory to determine the destiny of a people, but for a people to determine the destiny of a territory. It is a very nice thought, and it is difficult to disagree. But then, some 15 years earlier, another great jurist, Ivor Jennings, he was British, likewise famously stated, "The idea of self-determination seems to be reasonable. Let the people decide. In fact," he said, "it is ridiculous, because the people cannot decide before someone decides who the people is." And if I may add, the famous Australian movie or movie character, Crocodile Dundee, I saw it as a child, which was unfortunately a while ago. And I thought it was very funny when the main protagonist said, "People fighting for land ownership remind me of two fleas fighting for the ownership of the dog on which they live." Years later, when I started to study the right of self-determination, I discovered the whole depth of Crocodile Dundee's thought. And what implications does this now have for the Falklands/Malvinas dispute? Well, it is about setting a critical date. It is about who decides who the people is, and it is about who determines whose destiny. As I said, for Argentina, the critical date is 1816, the moment of independence from Spain, because so the Argentine view, Spain was in possession of the islands in that moment. And when Argentina became independent, it became independent together with the islands. The United Kingdom, on the other hand, claims that Britain has administered the islands since 1833. What makes the islands somewhat unusual is what I said in the introduction, that they had no native population. It is therefore not like southern Rhodesia, where a near uniform General Assembly resolution pronounced that its 1965 Declaration of Independence amounted to improper exercise of the right of self-determination as European settler minority excluded from government the native African majority. What is more, prior to 1833, no European colonial power, and after 1816, it is debatable to what extent even Argentina had established a continuous and permanent presence on the islands. It was occasional farmers and fishermen who lived there. The first known European settlers on the islands were otherwise French. They came, I believe, in 1764, and the British first arrived a couple of years later. The French and British settlements coexisted, and then they both left. France surrendered the claim over the islands to Spain, I believe in 1766, but the British claim also existed at the time. We thus have a history of European colonial powers coming and leaving, trading their interests. And then we have Argentina declaring independence in 1816, and Britain coming back in 1833. So how do we reconcile this mess? Is our critical date 1816? Is it 1833? Or is it perhaps sooner than that, or perhaps later? Well, the problem of critical dates is that it depends on who you ask. And the problem of history is that it depends on who is telling it. How should international law then deal with this? How far back in history should international law go when recognizing territorial claims? To avoid a potential mess, international law is premised on permanency of boundaries. This does not mean that boundaries can never be changed. Territorial integrity and permanency of boundaries are not absolute principles, as I indicated earlier. But there needs to be a prima facie presumption of territorial status quo. The starting point is always the most recent international boundary arrangement. But now again, is the most recent territorial arrangement for the Falklands 1816, 1833, or some other date? How about 1945, when the UN Charter system was established, which makes aggressive territorial conquest illegal? Prior to that, international law was quite different, and conquest was not always illegal. After all, Argentina itself is a product of Spanish conquest in South America, and the Falklands dispute an outcome of conflicting European interests far away from Europe. After World War II, aggression was prohibited, and colonial peoples got the right to free themselves from European domination. The paradigm of international law had radically changed. The history of modern boundaries is brutal and often completely unjust, but they need to be our default setting. Otherwise, we may end up legalizing conquest again. The 1833 British conquest or reconquest, depends how you define it, of the islands may remind us, mutatis mutandis, of present-day Crimea, which may now be effectively in possession of Russia, but it remains Ukrainian territory in law. So there is a difference between law and fact. Nowadays, in present international law, factual possession no longer leads to an automatic switch of the legal status of a territory. It is as if I steal your bike. I think I said that in my class, but so I'll repeat that. And if I steal your bike, I get to use it. I'm in factual possession, and I may even I take care of the bike, I use the bike, I enjoy the benefits of the bike, but the law will still treat that bike as your bike. Yet in the past, international law did not operate on this logic, and conquest was a recognized means of creating legal entitlements. International law in 1833 was quite different than in 2014 or 2016. As the ad for this event indicates, and as Fabian mentioned it in his introductory remarks, a General Assembly resolution was adopted in 1965, which called on both sides to negotiate the status of the islands. Negotiate. It did not say that a particular outcome had to be achieved. Negotiations indeed started, but the islanders strongly opposed any transfer of sovereignty. The negotiations then broke down, and the Argentine military intervention happened in 1982. The 1965 resolution was adopted 17 years before the invasion. And if certain, for example, perhaps, I'm speculating, shared sovereignty arrangements were perhaps politically feasible then, this was then hardly the case after 1982. In 2013, a referendum was held in the islands. At a turnout of 91.94%, 99.8% of those who casted votes voted in favor of staying a UK territory. Is this self-determination? Now, are the Falklanders a people for the purposes of self-determination? Remember Ivor Jennings, who decides who the people is? At the end of the day, then, are Austrians sufficiently different from Germans to be a separate people? What makes the Swiss a separate people? Or is there indeed a people of Belgium? Or if there is more than one Belgian identity, what makes the Flemish people sufficiently different from the Dutch? And what makes the Argentines sufficiently different from the Chileans? Collective identity may determine a legal entitlement because self-determination is a right of a people, of peoples, and of a separate people. But the problem is that there is no legal definition of a people. It is an inherently sociological, anthropological definition. It is a matter of collective self-perception. Such identities may be relatively recently realized, and their relationship with a territory is a complex one. I would say that it is probably that the influence goes both ways. People determine the destiny of the territory, and the territory determines the destiny of the people. And it is quite likely that the 1982 Argentine intervention only strengthened the separate Falklander identity. The definition of a people, I think, is an old trap of self-determination, and one should not too easily fall into it. In practice, self-determination, even before it was called like that, was always applied territorially, within territorial units in which the population exhibited a certain degree of a common identity, which was separate from others, be that on the basis of language, religion, creed, historic circumstances, geographic division, or purely political separation. It is often difficult to identify and confine those units, but that's a bit easier, perhaps, if you're an island. In contemporary international law, it is no longer acceptable to transfer the territory to another sovereign power against the wishes of the population of that territory, regardless of how illegitimate historic acquisition of that territory was. But show me one territory, the acquisition of which was perceived as being just by everyone. It's difficult to find one. This is now not to say that the will of the people is an absolute category of international law. By no means. A successful referendum of independence does not create a state, in that it does not automatically shift territorial sovereignty in any other way. But the will of the people can at least prevent cession of a territory to another state. Now, to illustrate, if Dutch Limburg voted in favor of merger with Belgium, the Dutch government would be under no legal obligation to actually cede it to Belgium. But if Dutch and Belgian governments concluded a treaty on ceding Dutch Limburg to Belgium, it would have been illegal under contemporary international law to cede this territory to Belgium against the wishes of the people of Dutch Limburg. And it is completely immaterial here to theorize whether or not the Limburgers qualify as a separate people for the purposes of the right of self-determination. If there was a real and present possibility that they could be ceded to another sovereign authority, I think this would create a unifying identity, even if such an identity did not necessarily exist before. And the population who faces such a possibility that would have such a major impact on their lives, that they could be suddenly collectively living under sovereign just because they live in certain territory, need to have a say in such matters, regardless of how homogeneous that group is otherwise. To give you an example, the franchise at Scottish independence referendum included UK, then British Commonwealth, and EU citizens who were in residence in Scotland, because they would all be affected by the vote, because they populated the territory which would change its sovereign, so to say, so which could become independent had the vote confirmed it. So even if you're otherwise Dutch, you could be Scottish for the purpose of a Scottish independence voting if you lived in Scotland. You would, in that sense, count toward the people of Scotland. And in my view, this then illustrates that the self-determination talk is often somewhat redundant and circular. When we always then fall into the trap of a definition of a people. Our identities may be in flux, and under some circumstances and for some purposes, everyone can be Scottish, British, Dutch, Limburger, Argentine, or perhaps indeed a Falklander. And when the territory so on which we live is to be transferred to another sovereign authority, it is the right, it is only right that we are consulted on the future of that territory on the basis of an inclusive territorial principle, rather than engage in theoretical debate of what constitutes a people, which is a never-ending debate. With regards to the Falklands, I can say that even if we accept that the Argentine 1816 claim is correct in principle, it would be problematic that writing a justice from 200 years, because it could create a new injustice. We always need to be careful when we entertain certain historic territorial claims. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yuri, for a fascinating tour d'horizon of the origins, the roots of the principle, the right to self-determination, and of the manifold intricacies and complexities. Thank you also for your very provocative conclusions. I do hope for a debate on your conclusions, but before we will enter that debate, we will have our second speaker, and I'm very, very happy indeed to welcome here Professor Marcelo Cohn, who is a professor of international law at the Graduate Institute of International and Development Studies in Geneva, where he has been a member of the faculty since 1995. Professor Cohen is a titular member of the Institut de Droit International and also its Secretary General since 2015. It's further interesting to inform you that he has worked as a legal counsel and advocate for a number of states before the International Court of Justice, the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, and other tribunals. And he also acts as an arbitrator. He has been a visiting professor at several European universities and rapporteur or co-rapporteur for the International Law Association, the Council of Europe, and the Institut de Droit International. He is, moreover, the author of many publications in the field of international law in English, French, and Spanish. He is generally interested in research related to international law theory, territorial, maritime, and border disputes, as well as international dispute settlement. And I also would like to highlight that he was awarded the Paul Guggenheim Prize in 1997 for his book, Possession Contestée et Souveraineté Territoriale. He is presently a candidate to the United Nations International Law Commission, appointed by Argentina and by Switzerland. It's a great pleasure to have you here in Maastricht. Most welcome, and I give you the floor.
Well, dear colleagues, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to come back to Maastricht. I thank you, the organizers, the Maastricht University, for giving me this opportunity to speak about this long-standing dispute. So I put as a title of my presentation the Falklands Malvinas, a casus classicus of territorial disputes. And indeed, if you have a look at this dispute, you will find nearly all the ingredients of territorial disputes, theoretically and in practice. I would even say to my colleagues, if you have to teach the questions concerning acquisition of territorial sovereignty in international law, you have here the best example in which you can speak about nearly everything which is related to territorial disputes, because you will have questions concerning discovery, you will have questions concerning the right of first occupant, you will have questions concerning abandonment, about acquiescence, about the relevance of treaties, and the impact of fundamental principles of international law. As Yuri demonstrated a moment ago, there are questions concerning the applicability or not of the right of peoples to self-determination, the questions concerning the obligation to respect the territorial integrity of states, questions concerning the prohibition of the use of force, and even doctrinal questions such as the existence or not of acquisitive prescription in international law and the relevance of conquest as a valid title for the acquisition of territorial sovereignty. So you have all the ingredients in a single case. So this is, for a professor of international law, rather a wonderful situation, because you can use it and you have everything there. But it is also interesting from a doctrinal point of view, not only from the international legal perspective, but also with regard to political science or with regard to international relations in general. Because here you have a dispute between a newly independent state, that is to say a state that emerged from decolonization, early decolonization in the 19th century, versus a colonial power. And you have also a situation between might and right, because, as Yuri mentioned, there is a de facto situation lasting. So in one case, you have a state able to keep a given factual situation, and you have another state which just have the possibility to raise protests, to lodge protests, but cannot transform this de facto situation. So, Jure spoke about, if this work, okay. Jure mentioned the problem of critical date. Indeed, in any territorial dispute, one of the first tasks any tribunal or any court does is to determine what is the critical date. Because in any dispute, particularly in territorial sovereignty disputes, these are long-standing disputes in general. And you have to define one particular moment in which you have to analyze the positions taken by the parties. And this is the idea of critical date. And you will see in a moment that I will provide another critical date from those mentioned by Jure a moment ago. Because if you have a look at the case law of the International Court of Justice, but also arbitral tribunals, this idea of critical date was mentioned for the first time in the well-known Palmas Island arbitration. Max Huber was the only arbitrator in this case. And the idea of critical days is a moment in which the dispute crystallizes. That is to say, a moment in which it is clear that there is a dispute and it is clear what the positions of the parties are. That is to say, you have a territory, you have one state claiming this territory, invoking some arguments in order to defend its position, and then you have another state claiming the same territory and invoking its own arguments. At that moment, the positions of the parties are fixed, and then you have to analyze who is right and who is wrong. And I will propose another critical date from that, or those proposed by Jure, because, well, he mentioned it depends on where do you place the critical date, maybe the outcome will be different. Indeed, the idea of the technical use of the critical date is to avoid this, and to have an objective moment in which you analyze the positions advanced by the parties. And in my view, one critical date you can use in order to determine who is right and who is wrong is the moment in which both countries claim the same territory and explain their positions. And this situation arose in 19th of November 1829. I will explain in a moment. Argentina consider itself as the successor of Spain. Spain was in possession of the territory at the time of Argentinian independence. Argentina exercised some acts of authority over the islands, and then in 1829 it established a separate administrative unit for the islands. That was the decree of 10th of June 1829. In this decree, as I will mention in a moment, Argentina explained why the islands were Argentinians. And then the British government lost a protest in 19th of November 1829, in which it also explained why, according to the British government, the islands were British. So this is a moment in which you can analyze the position of both parties. You have in front of you the relevant part of the Argentinian decree in which it explained why the islands belong to Argentina. You have the text of the British protest of 19th of November 1829. I will summarize both positions, and you will see what the situation is. So the position of Argentina, as explained in the decree of June 1829, is that Argentina is the successor from Spain. That is to say, in order to determine that the islands belong to Argentina, you have to explain why Spain was the sovereign. And this is what the decree established in 1829. So, Spain was in possession of the islands at the time of Argentine independence. Spain may claim the title of first occupant because the first possession was the French one, and this is uncontroversial. Nobody denies that the first state to occupy the islands was France, and France recognized Spanish sovereignty and then transferred its settlement to Spain. So Spain can claim the right of the first occupant derived by France. You have the recognition of Spanish sovereignty by other powers, France and Great Britain, and also the decree mentioned the adjacency of the islands to the Spanish mainland. And this is a point in which I would like to clarify something. This is not a matter of claiming territorial sovereignty because of the proximity, just the mere proximity. But at that time, what was important was the idea of the extension of the different colonial powers' control over the world. And it was not necessary that every portion of the territory that was considered to be Spanish, British, French, Portuguese, etc., or Dutch, was effectively occupied. So the idea of contiguity is just an idea to determine the extent of territorial sovereignty and not to create territorial sovereignty. So these were the arguments advanced by Argentina in order to demonstrate that Argentina was the successor to the rights of Spain. And here, my colleagues, students of law, are familiar with the idea of, or the notion of uti possidetis, which you can call it as you wish, but what is clear, and it is also uncontroversial, is the fact that a newly independent state succeed in the territorial extension of the former colonial unit. That is to say, or even today, in cases of separation of states or dissolution of states, the idea of state succession to territory. Call it uti possidetis or not. And then after the beginning of the process of independence in Argentina, Argentina also displayed its authority over the islands. So these are the basis of the Argentine claim. Obviously, as Yuri mentioned, in 1833, the British expelled Argentina from the islands and they are under the territorial control since that time till today. So Argentina considered that this is beyond, obviously, the decree, because it's after the situation is after the critical day. The taking of possession by Britain in 1833 was illegal, and I will explain in a moment why conquest cannot be invoked in this situation. There was no Argentine consent to the British occupation since 1833. And this is also an important point, because one could say, as Yuri mentioned, there are different unjust situations all over the world, but we cannot remake history and what happened one century ago or two centuries ago. It's an injustice, but we should have to live with this. it is not so simple, because if this particular dispute is still alive, it is because of the position adopted by the British government in 1833 onwards. That is to say, refusal to settle the dispute, with some exceptions very later on, when the process of decolonization started at the time of the United Nations. And then Argentina also invoked the fact that its sovereignty is widely recognized at the international level. What is the position of the British government? Again, if you have a look at the protest of November 1829, you will see that the British government invoked discovery, subsequent occupation, the Spanish restoration of Port Egmont in 1771, the fact that the British, when they withdrew from the islands, from Port Egmont in particular, because they were only in Port Egmont, in 1774, there was no intention to abandon its sovereignty. That is what the protest of November 1829 mentioned as basis for British sovereignty. It is later on that the United Kingdom advanced new arguments. The fact of being administering the islands since 1833, and that's a new argument, the fact that Argentina would have relinquished its claim. And now, since the population of the islands is essentially British, they claim the right of peoples to self-determination. Let me say a few words about some of these arguments. The question of discovery. First of all, discovery is not and was not at the time when the dispute emerged a title to sovereignty. It was considered to be, as Max Huber mentioned in the Palmas Island case, an inchoate title. That is to say, it opened the way to later on occupy the territory and be the sovereign by virtue of this occupation. By the way, some of the islands of the archipelago were discovered by a Dutch sailor, Sebald de Vert. And as far as I know, the Netherlands has not yet claimed sovereignty over the Falklands Malvinas. But what is also clear, and even British authors recognized, is that the alleged discovery of the islands by a British sailor in 1590, if I'm not mistaken, indeed, it is clear and there is evidence that other sailors from other nations were in the islands, even Spanish sailors remained for months in the island earlier. So you have in front of you the first ever map on the islands, which was drawn in 1520. You have another map of 1522, in which also the islands are depicted together with the South American continent. And these were maps prepared after the Magellan trip all over the world, as you know. And most probably, this was the origin of the discovery of these islands by Europeans. So in any case, it is clear that discovery is not a basis for territorial sovereignty, and even if it were, Britain was not the discoverer of the islands. Now let me say a few words about the question of Port Egmont, because that was one of the arguments. Jure mentioned the first settlers, the first European to establish a settlement in the islands were the French, 1764. Then the British came and established a garrison in another point of the islands 1 year later. In other words, it is not the right of first occupant, because when you have, and this is also a question of terra nullius, acquisition of territorial sovereignty of a terra nullius, so the one who acquires sovereignty is the first occupant. The first occupant were the French and not the British. Consequently, Britain cannot claim to be the first occupant and consequently having the right of first occupant. But what happened? So as I mentioned, the French recognized Spanish sovereignty and then they transferred its settlement to the Spaniards. And once the Spaniards discovered that there was a British settlement on the other part of the archipelago, they went and they expelled the British. And then this put both states close to a situation of war, and in order to avoid war, there was an agreement. And the agreement was to restore, and this is the text which is quite clear, to restore, the Spaniards restored the British settlement in Port Egmont, but reserved its right to sovereignty. At the same time, Spain was always in the islands, and this is a very important point. There has never been, at that time, prior to Argentine independence, there has never been a situation in which the British were controlling the islands alone. Never. On the contrary, there was a situation in which the Spanish were in control of the island alone, exclusively, and over the whole archipelago. So here you have the Spanish declaration, the British declaration, and you see that what this declaration, this agreement established was to restore the settlement. This was a satisfaction for the injury caused by the use of force by Spain against the British. And that's all. The rest of the story, you know it. So after this, 3 years later, when the honor of the British government was preserved, the British government withdrew the settlement of Port Egmont, they say, due to economic reasons, and Spain remained on control of the whole archipelago until the time of Argentinian independence. The British withdrew from Port Egmont, then Spain controlled the whole archipelago. Even the Spaniards destroyed the British fort that was there. There was no reaction by the British government. The signs of sovereignty that were left were withdrawn by the Spaniards. There was no reaction by the British government. So, as I said, Argentina claimed to be the successor of Spain and acted accordingly. And this is also important. From the very beginning of the process of independence, there are a number of acts that in the legal terminology, they are calling with the French word effectivité. You have a list of all these different acts that were accomplished exclusively by Argentina. There was no other state performing acts of sovereignty during this whole period. In particular, which is interesting, is the taking of possession of Argentina in 1820. Because the Spaniards, when the process of independence the struggle for independence started in South America. The Spaniards withdrew their settlement in the islands in order to to focus all their efforts fighting against the independentist movement in South America. So since then, the islands remained uninhabited. So in 1820, there is a taking of possession by an agent of the Argentine government. And this was a public act performed in the presence of sailors from different nations, included British sailors. And this was even published in 1821 in the Times of London. That is to say, that was a very well-known fact. And the British government didn't say anything, and the British government didn't act in any manner with regard to the islands. Because if you see that someone took possession of a territory you consider yours, the least one can expect is that you send either a protest or at least someone to the islands in order to claim that these islands belong to you. At that time, there was no recognition of the independence of Argentina by the British government at that time. But in any case, if there was no will to enter into contact with a non-recognized state, the question what one can expect is, if you consider yourself sovereigns of the islands, then you have to go and perform some act of authority. Nothing of this happened. So there were, in the 1820s, there were plenty of acts of Argentine authority, and indeed, that was the first successful attempt to bring civilization to the islands. There was an Argentine settlement which was successful, which was there for a number of years, and it was that once this was well known, that in the islands there was a settlement, the people were there, there were about 150 inhabitants, it was very useful for navigation, that was, at that time, there was no Panama Canal, that was the interoceanic passage between the Atlantic and the Pacific, and that was the reason why at the British Admiralty someone considered that it would be worth having a position in this part of the world. And this is how the story about the British interest in the islands started again after decades and decades of absolute British uninterest on the islands. There were discussions within the British government about the question of the Malvinas, Falkland Islands. The head of government, the Duke of Wellington, wrote the following in 1829. That is to say, just before the protest lodged by the British government against the Argentine decree. And the Duke of Wellington said the following: I have perused the enclosed papers respecting the Falkland Islands. It is not clear to me that we have ever possessed the sovereignty over all those islands. Then there was the Act of Force of 1833. So the British expelled Argentina, and then since then they are controlling the situation. So there were protests from the very beginning, and the British attitude was that there would be no discussions, no negotiations, the matter is closed. That was the answer the British government always sent to the Argentine every time that there was a protest. And the position of Argentina was mentioned by its representative in London. Since you don't even accept to discuss the issue, or even not even answer our notes, you have to know that you cannot consider that if we do not react because you don't answer, you are not willing to answer, this cannot be considered to be acquiescence. And in 1849, there was a discussion in the parliament, and Lord Palmerston said that the matter had been dropped because of the acquiescence of one party. Then there was a new Argentine protest, and the answer by Lord Palmerston was that the situation remained as it was described by the Argentine representative in London. That is to say, that Argentina has never consented to the deprivation of their sovereignty over the Falklands Malvinas. But very, very recently, there is a new argument which was first made official by the United Kingdom in 2013. There was a situation in the South American continent of conflict with regard to the navigation of the South American rivers. The position of the South American countries was that there was no freedom of navigation. That is to say, if you want to enter a river, or a South American river, you need the permission of the riparian state. That is to say, Argentina, Uruguay, Brazil, etc., etc. France and Britain had another view. They considered that they could enter the rivers, the South American rivers, without any kind of permission. And then there was a blockade of the Rio de la Plata. If you have, if you imagine the South American map, you will see that there is the largest river of the world, which is an estuary, which is the Rio de la Plata, between Argentina and Uruguay. There was a blockade by Britain and by France. What is interesting is that despite of this blockade, the representative of Argentina remained in London. There have never been a break of diplomatic relations between Argentina and Britain, even after the act of force of 1833. So there were negotiations, and the question of the blockade of the Rio de la Plata and the navigation of the rivers was settled. And that was settled with two different treaties, one with Britain, another with France. And now the British government considers that by this treaty, Argentina relinquished its claim. But what is the content of the treaty? Because you are good lawyers, and you know when you have a treaty, well, you have to look at the content of the treaty in order to determine its scope. What is the scope of this treaty? It is clearly mentioned in Article 1. This treaty put an end to the difference which have interrupted the political and commercial relations between the two countries, having on the 15th of July 1847 raised the blockade which it had established of the port of the two republics of the Plata, etc., etc., etc. So that is to say, this treaty just settled the dispute concerning the blockade of the Rio de la Plata. It was Uruguay was also concerned by this treaty, because this very same treaty established that it will be effective once Argentina obtained the consent of the Uruguayan government. So, and the question of the navigation of the rivers. That's exactly what this treaty settled. But now it is invoked, I would say even very late, as having also settled the question of the Falklands Malvinas. The fact is that there were other protests, and in 1884 there was even a proposal by Argentina to settle the matter by arbitration, but the British government did not accept this. So there have been many situations in which the British government even accepted that the Argentine position has not changed. For instance, in 1911, a general treaty of arbitration was negotiated between Argentina and the United Kingdom. And this raised some internal discussions within the British government, and the Colonial Office was very worried about the possibility of having the Falklands Malvinas dispute been brought to arbitration because of this treaty. And this is what the foreign secretary mentioned to his colleague of the Colonial Office. Foreign Secretary Sir Gray does not propose the conclusion of a treaty of arbitration with the Argentine government until the British title to the Falkland Islands has been recognized in 1911. It means the British were absolutely aware that Argentina has never recognized the de facto situation. And here, allow me to say a few words about the question of abandonment or acquiescence, because it is possible that a state having a claim may abandon it or may acquiesce to the position of the other. So this is a question that they are often advanced in territorial disputes. And this is what the ICJ mentioned in a case concerning Malaysia and Singapore. The passing of sovereignty over territory on the basis of the conduct of the parties must be manifested clearly and without any doubt by that conduct and the relevant facts. That is especially so if what may be involved in the case of one of the parties is in effect the abandonment of sovereignty over part of its territory. In other words, it is not easy to prove the existence of abandonment or relinquishment. So there must be a clear situation in which there is such a thing. So let me conclude with regard to territorial sovereignty, and then I will say a few words about the question of self-determination. So if you compare the claims of both parties at the time of the critical date, I believe that it is not difficult to consider that the Argentine position is very strong. The United Kingdom has relied on the title of discovery, which is not a title and which is not confirmed by the facts. I would say that the British taking of possession of 1833 was illegal because jure, it is true that conquest was a valid title to sovereignty at that time. But allow me to say two things. One, Britain has never claimed that it acquired sovereignty by conquest. And coherence is required in international law and relations, I would even add. So you cannot claim that you are sovereign, you cannot lodge a protest invoking different titles and then using force and then say, well, now I'm the sovereign because I use force and I won and I'm the sovereign. So you have to be coherent. Never, the United Kingdom has never claimed conquest as a basis of territorial sovereignty. But secondly, and probably most importantly, even at the time in which conquest was a valid title to acquire territorial sovereignty, it was subject to some conditions. One cannot believe that since the use of force was permitted, states could resort to force in any way or in any manner, because in order to acquire sovereignty by conquest, at the time these facts occurred, 1833, it was clear from an international legal viewpoint that there were some conditions. That conditions were the existence of a state of war between the states concerned. That is to say, at that time, there were formal declarations of war. You were in state of war if you declare war to the other side. Nothing of this occurred. On the contrary, there was a treaty of friendship commerce and navigation between Argentina and the and Great Britain at that time. So there was no state of war. And nobody claimed that they were in war, that there was war between these two countries. So it was an act of force exercised at a time of peace between the two countries. Secondly, in order to have conquest, the victor obviously has to be in possession of the territory, but then there must be a third condition, which is the existence of a treaty of peace by which the defeated state relinquishes its sovereignty. Nothing of this occurred in 1833 or after 1833. That is to say, through the protests, through the proposals to settle the dispute, Argentina maintained its position. Acquisitive prescription. Again, this is a very controversial means of acquisition of territorial sovereignty. In international law, if you consult a library, you will have half of the library considering that it is a valid title to territorial sovereignty, and the other half saying exactly the opposite. And this is so since the times of Grotius until today. So this is a controversial issue. Acquisitive prescription. Does it exist in international law or not? There are two opposite views. But what is essential, in my view, what call it acquisitive prescription or not, is, in my view, there are two essential things here. The passing of time, because acquisitive prescription is based on the idea of the passing of time. Even if a situation is illegal, if it lasts, then it can become legal. What is essential is not just the passing of time. What is essential is what occurs during the passing of time. And even if more than a century and a half has passed, you have to take into account not that only, but what happened. And what happened is one state maintaining its position and the other essentially refusing to negotiate and to settle this dispute. Under these conditions, it is difficult to say that the mere passing of time had created a title. So this is, in a nutshell, my conclusion with regard to the opposite titles. But allow me to say a word about self-determination, because nobody denies that self-determination is a fundamental principle of contemporary international law. It took time for the United Kingdom to recognize this, but today, nobody denies that this is a fundamental principle of international law. And the question is about the uses and abuses of the right of peoples to self-determination. Because it is not enough to say self-determination and then the matter is settled. The question is to concretely analyze whether this principle is applicable to a given situation and under which conditions. This is a fundamental question. And in international law, you have different human communities having different kind of rights. In international law, you have provisions concerning peoples in the sense of the right of peoples to self-determination. You have also rules concerning indigenous peoples, which they have been recognized as holder of the internal aspect of self-determination. And then you have national and other minorities. All of them have collective rights. I'm not talking about individual human rights. We all have human rights. But Yure, I would like to tell you, we don't have, as individuals, the right to decide territorial sovereignty. I have not the right to decide whether the place in which I live is part of one state or another. There is no individual, there is not such individual human right to decide territorial sovereignty. There are collective rights. We have as individuals the human right to participate in the political life of the country to which we are citizens or to some extent where we live. But this is one thing. We have political rights, but these political rights do not include the right to decide territorial sovereignty. And I will come back to, in a moment, I will come back to some examples showing what I mentioned. So you have three different kind of human communities recognized by international law. For each of these communities, international law grants different rights. Because if all of them would have the right of peoples to self-determination, there would be no need to distinguish. So why to distinguish the situation of a national minority if they have the right to self-determination? So if everybody has the right to self-determination, then there is no need to make such a distinction. And it is not enough for a human community to declare itself to be a people in order to have the right to self-determination. Otherwise, it would be very simple and there would be not even discussions. It would be not necessary for the Spanish government to discuss whether the Catalonians are a separate people entitled to self-determination if it is for the human community concerned to decide. So in no legal system you have this kind of self-definition. So and then you have the rights according to your own position. This is an objective situation which is determined by the law itself. And the question of recognition at the international level of the existence of a people, in my view, is very important. And this is what the ICJ mentioned in the advisory opinion on the construction of a wall by Israel on the occupied Palestinian territory. As regards the principle of the right of peoples to self-determination, the court observes that the existence of a Palestinian people, the inverted commas are by the court, is no longer in issue. That is to say, it is not enough to say by the group or by a state. You have a people there, then it is entitled to self-determination. It's a matter in which international recognition plays a very important point. And in some cases, in the process of decolonization, the General Assembly, the organ of the UN playing the most important role in the process of decolonization, because it is for this organ to determine whether a territory falls within the realm of Chapter 11 of the Charter and Resolution 1514 of the General Assembly. In some cases, the General Assembly did not apply or did not require the consultation of the population of the territory concerned. And this is the explanation given by the ICJ in the Western Sahara case, advisory opinion. In some cases, the General Assembly considered that a certain population did not constitute a people entitled to self-determination. That's quite clear. And this is what happened with regard to the situation of the Malvinas Falkland Islands. This sometimes works and sometimes not. Here you have Resolution 2065 mentioned by Fabian at the very beginning. Last year was the 50th anniversary of this resolution, the first resolution adopted by the UN concerning the Falklands Malvinas. And here there is a reference to the existence of a dispute of sovereignty, the situation of the island as one of the forms of colonialism, the need for negotiations and to take into account the interest of the population. That is to say, there is a reference to the interest, there is no reference at all to the applicability of self-determination, contrary to what happened in what could consider the normal cases of decolonizations, in which you have a people being victim of the colonialism and then entitled to self-determination. If you have a look at the resolution concerning East Timor, you will see a blatant difference between one resolution and the other. Here, the first thing the resolution does is to mention the right of peoples to self-determination and the applicability of the principle to the Timorese people. So this is a clear example of the difference between the two cases. So there were plenty of other resolutions given in the same direction. I will try to make the story short in order to allow you to participate. So the United Kingdom in 1985 was proposed to introduce the idea of self-determination in the resolution concerning the Falklands Malvinas, but this proposal was rejected by the General Assembly. So my point of view here is that it has not been recognized that there is a Falkland Islanders people separated one, a unit of self-determination, for the reasons what I mentioned a moment ago. But even if you have a look at the composition and the demography of the islands, because Jure mentioned there was an injustice in the past, but maybe if you solve this injustice, you create a new one. Is this applicable to the Falklands Malvinas? He didn't go so far to say yes. But in my view, the answer is no. Here you have a population that was established by the British government, in which population we are talking about just of at the most 2,840 inhabitants. That was the last census. The next one will be organized tomorrow and on Sunday, this weekend indeed. This is the population of the island, and you see the evolution of the population. And if you have a look at the composition of the population, you will find some elements that are very interesting. We are not talking about a population of a territory in which you have millions of inhabitants and there is a normal demographic growth due to birth and deaths, etc., etc., etc. So you have a very small population and you have the power controlling the demography of this territory. To apply self-determination in this context, in my view, is, to say the least, very controversial. And if you have a look at the censuses, you will find that 40% of the population have lived in the islands for less than 10 years. And this happened again and again after one census and another. So you have 40% of the inhabitants that arrived to the islands just in 10 years ago. Can you consider that this population is a separate people entitled to self-determination? In this context, I would rather say the answer is no. Even the natives, because it is true that you have, and I have plenty of respect for these inhabitants, you can trace their past in generations living in the islands. That's and these deserve not only respect but also protection. But one thing is these inhabitants, and another thing is people just having come to the islands from the United Kingdom and then claiming to be Falkland Islanders entitled to self-determination. So
And the position of Argentina, in my view, is very clear. Argentina has not adopted an absolute position or even an extreme position. Argentina is not claiming that this population must be expelled, sent to the United Kingdom, etc., etc., etc. So even it is in the Argentine constitution that Argentina committed to respect the way of life of these inhabitants. And this is an important point. I have to conclude. So, no right of not a separate people entitled to self-determination. And I could even mention some British inconsistencies in the claim of self-determination, because when the population is British, they say self-determination. When it is not, they don't claim self-determination. But I would like to finish by mentioning two cases, which shows that, in my view, what Yuri advanced with regard to transfers of territory without taking into account the wishes of the inhabitants is not as simple as it looks. So you have El Salvador-Honduras, a dispute which was brought before the ICJ. The whole boundary was under discussion. And as a result of the judgment, between 10,000 and 30,000 Salvadorians were living in what the court considered to be Honduras territory. You have also the Bakassi Peninsula between Cameroon and Nigeria. In Bakassi, there were 100,000 Nigerians living. But the court analyzed the titles and considered that this territory belonged to Cameroon. And what the court said in both cases is that the vested rights of the inhabitants must be preserved and respected. The interests of the population should be taken into account and respected. And this is exactly the situation in any other territorial dispute. So you have to respect the rights of the population. But it is not just for the population to take stance, because there must be many different reasons. I don't have time to explain. But the court analyzed the titles and decide who has sovereignty and who has not sovereignty. So I don't have time to mention some legal views of British civil servants of the rank of Sir Gerald Fitzmaurice, for instance, who became judge of the ICJ. But I would like to finish with the words of an American scholar who wrote one of the most important books, historical and legal books on this matter, who was Julius Gebel. He finished his analysis of the territorial dispute between Argentina and Britain, saying that the law which states have so painstakingly wrought to govern their relations is too precious a heritage to be suborned to cover the imperialistic designs of any nation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marcelo, for a most interesting and most informative analysis of the competing claims, and for your clear conclusions. And I think, dear colleagues and friends, that we can praise ourselves very happy to be very happy because of the fact that we have been presented with such an interesting survey of the competing claims to sovereignty in the case of the Falklands, Malvinas Islands. I very much appreciate it also that you already started the discussion with Yuri Widmar on the relevance of the principle and the right to self-determination, and I will certainly give Yuri the opportunity to reflect on the points that you have made. But before doing so, and I would like to invite the audience, and that was the reason, by the way, that I asked Professor Corin to wind up. I would like to give the audience the opportunity to also participate in a discussion, and I do hope that in the framework of that discussion, those points, remaining points that Professor Corin would have liked to share with us can be brought up by him. The rules for the discussion are very simple indeed. Try to be as brief as possible so that as many members of the audience can participate in discussion as possible, and mention your name, your affiliation, and then raise your comments or your question. To whom could I give the floor first? Yes.
My name is Agustin Parise from Maastricht University, and my question goes mainly to Professor Cohen. In your legal historical overview of the events that led to the current situation, you very briefly mentioned or stopped on the armed conflict of 1982. And my question is mainly an invitation for you, now that we have a little more time, to develop on that area, just to build a context about that, those events and the more recent events that have been taking place. I guess this will be also addressed in the third panel, but I thought it would be nice to have a short context or a small context here in this first panel. Thank you.
Yes. In 1982, Argentina resorted to force. And in my view, that was an illegal act, because there is an obligation to settle international dispute using peaceful means, and resorted to force was not in accordance with international law. That's the first point. I have to remember that Argentina was governed at that time by a military dictatorship, but the question is that it was Argentina who used force in an illegal way. First point. Second point. Does this fact, the fact of having used force in an illegal way, change the question of the existence of a dispute about territorial sovereignty? And my answer to this is no, it doesn't change anything. And this was even acknowledged by the British government. When the British government went to the Security Council in order to obtain a resolution condemning Argentina for its use of force, that was the resolution adopted 502 of 1982. So the British representative, Sir Anthony Parsons, I have the quote here, he said, because he knew that in order to obtain the vote, the necessary votes, there were states, members of the Security Council, that even recognized Argentinian sovereignty. So he had to convince these states to vote against Argentina, and he was able to do so. And he said, and I'm quoting him, this was not, I repeat, not in any sense to discuss the rights or wrongs of the very long-standing issue between Great Britain and Argentina over the islands in the South Atlantic. The only intention of the British request was, I quote, to deter any threat of armed force. And then, once the facts occurred, that is to say Argentina used force, again, before the Security Council, he said it was not in any sense concerned with the merits. It was entirely in response to this armed invasion. So, and I could continue the quotes. And that was indeed the case. So one thing is using force illegally or not, and another thing is the existence of territorial sovereignty, who has sovereignty. And even after the end of hostilities, the General Assembly adopted a new resolution by which it reaffirmed what I showed you a moment ago, that is to say that there is a particular colonial situation, there is a dispute of sovereignty, the dispute of sovereignty should be settled through negotiations, taking into account the interests of the inhabitants. That is to say, the war and its outcome did not change the territorial sovereignty question.
The idea was also to mention to the audience at large that Argentina reaches the island in April of 1982, and it leaves the island in June of that same year, leaving many casualties behind, and it was mainly to give that context, the short time span of 2 months. Thank you.
Yeah, correct. Mark Wessel, University of Nottingham. My question, and a few points as well, for Jo Widmer. Initially, I thought it was quite fascinating that you mentioned how the context of the debate in of itself, the issue that self-determination raises and the concept of the people can actually crystallize the notion of a people in of itself. I thought that was quite an interesting idea to present. It's almost self-perpetuating and self-fulfilling in that sense. Another point which, or a question which I want to pose to you was, you mentioned the significance of that self-determination didn't develop until after the birth of the United Nations, and I just wanted to question as to what role you think that plays within the dispute, because you then related back to saying that the dispute originated pre that point, and I'm not quite certain what the temporal consequences of that are. I think there's one other point, 2 seconds, bear with me. And the final point is even if we were to accept that the UK had violated the right to self-determination in relation to Hong Kong, which is arguable, does that then preclude the legal application of self-determination to a later point? I think that's an interesting question to ask. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yuri.
Thank you for these questions. If I start actually at the end, I would say I do believe that a consultation should have been held in the case of Hong Kong, but Britain nevertheless decided to hand over Hong Kong back to China. But then, in that case, if you try to draw some parallels to the Falklands, so first of all, the Falklands Islands did not have any original native population, so that was one of the differences to Hong Kong, and what is more. So when negotiations after that 1965 resolution. The negotiations were taking place, but then the British government stopped negotiating because the Falklanders were so opposed to it, and as far as I know, they lobbied very strongly in Westminster that the negotiations would stop because they did not want to consider any possible arrangements with Argentina. Now, had then that invade, so when the invasion happened, the negotiations were no longer taking place. And had that invasion not happened, then would then British government start negotiating again? I guess we will never know. But what happened after 1982, and I agree with Marcelo that this does not change the nature of the dispute, but the political circumstances are completely different, because now it would be difficult for any British government in the future to start negotiating again and try to strike a new deal for the sovereignty of the Falklands, because it was such a unifying moment, this war for actually not just for the Falklanders but for the entire UK. So I think here, legally speaking, yes, there was big. So there is no shift in the nature of the dispute, but the political circumstances have changed, and the possibility of reaching an agreement by negotiations is much weaker now. It's almost non-existent. And I do believe now it is debatable. In the Falklands, of course, one of the problems when we are looking at the population and self-determination is that we are talking about relatively few people in number. So it's not even 3,000 according to the past census. And indeed, yes, 40% of the population is there for less than 10 years. But nevertheless, I think an event like that does crystallize identities. And this is not only for the Falklands, but we can see other examples. We could then also ask, for example, not in Brexit or actually open another difficult question of Kosovo. So are Kosovo Albanians a separate people or not? And did not relatively recent historic events perhaps help crystallizing their identity? And then thirdly, about this temporal element, I agree with you that it is questionable whether it does have any implications for the dispute that identities of a separate people had crystallized in the past before self-determination was a positive right, but I do not see any direct implications. But I just mentioned it as one of the considerations that has sometimes been invoked, and I think I had I forgot I wanted to make another point, but if I may ask Marcelo, when you interestingly mentioned that you think that the invasion in 1982 was illegal, but does that mean that it was a violation of Article 2.4?
Marcelo.
Yes, indeed, that was the case. It was a use of force contrary to the principles of the Charter, namely the obligation to settle international disputes through peaceful means. But it was a clear breach of Article 2, Paragraph 4. Even if you are the sovereign of a territory, you cannot settle disputes using force. I have to say that in the past there were other examples which were successful in the use of force, even though there were breaches to international law. For instance, in 1962 India used force in order to control the Portuguese enclaves. That was also a use of force. But India, at that time, there was exactly the same resolution proposed by Britain some years later with regard to the Malvinas Falklands. But at that time, the Soviet Union used its veto, and there was no Security Council resolution condemning Indian use of force. But as I said, one thing is the use of force, another is territorial sovereignty.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. Marco Beneta, Max Planck Institute, Luxembourg, and Free University of Brussels. My question goes to Professor Cohen, and it relates to self-determination and the law of the sea. So if we look at the third UN conference on the law of the sea, when they concluded the UNCLOS, they adopted a final act and a number of resolutions. And if we look at Resolution 3, it's very interesting, because it was adopted in a context of or with a concern for decolonization, and it basically says that the convention should be applied such that non-self-governing territories should reap the benefits of the UNCLOS. And I think this mainly pertains to the exploitation of natural resources. So it seems to still be relevant, the resolution. Professor Gwen referenced Chagos Archipelago, while in the recent arbitration over Chagos, there was a dissenting and partly concurring opinion of Judges Wolfholm and Kateka, I think, in which they explicitly referenced Resolution 3. So my question is, have Argentina and the UK adopted a position with respect to the applicability or non-applicability of this resolution to the Malvinas Falklands. Thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you for this question. Indeed, this resolution referred to non-self-government territories and the fact that UNCLOS should be applied for the benefit of the peoples of the non-self-government territories, and in cases of disputes as to territorial sovereignty over non-self-governing territories, so the exploitation of resources, for instance, should be done for the benefit of the peoples concerned. So Argentina made a declaration at the signing, while signing this the convention. This is a resolution included in the final act. It was not included as an article of the convention. Argentina made an interpretation and considered that this is not applicable to the question of the Falklands Malvinas. Again, what we come always to the same question: who are the people? And who is the victim of the colonial situation? Because when you analyze the applicability of self-determination to the Falklands Malvinas, in general, everybody analyzes the situation as whether self-determination is applicable to the current inhabitants of the island, and to the question whether they constitute a separate unit of self-determination, a separate people, etc., etc. But other manners to read the principle are possible, and I would even say, so if you have to determine who is the people concerned by the existence of this colonial situation, and who is the people, or who are the people victims of the colonial situation, I could say, well, it's the Argentine people. And you have to take into account, if you want to apply self-determination, one could say, well, it is for the Argentine people, because the Argentine people was deprived of part of its territory, and it has the right to use the entirety of its territory and its resources. So there are different ways to interpret this. Thanks.
Yuri, on this point?
On this point, yes, I would say that, here maybe I have a slightly different view, because that would be a violation of the, so we have two sides of self-determination here. One of the sides is whether or not the Falklanders should have the rights stemming from the law of self-determination, and secondly, is there actually presently any violation of the right of self-determination of the Argentine people. And the very somewhat peculiar circumstance compared to some other self-determination claims is that there was no original native population of the islanders and of the islands. And of course that would have been a violation of the right of self-determination had British settlers arrived and colonized the not only the territory but also the population who lived there. But we did not have that happen in the case of the Falklands Islands. But then another aspect of that, are the Falklanders a people of the for the purposes of the right of self-determination, I think this is what I try to what I try to argue in my talk, that we should not perhaps fall into the trap of this of these definitions, but just ask ourselves: is it in this particular circumstance? Does international law allow transfer of the territory against explicit wishes of its population? Now, but then we can debate whether this territory does have a permanent core of population or not. I mean, this is then debatable. But I do not think
that we need to answer, or that our starting point is there an identity of a separate people?
Yes, good morning. My name is Francisco César Zamora. I'm from the University of Buenos Aires, and I'm now an exchange at the Universidad Católica de Lugo. So my knowledge of the whole Malvinas, Falkland Islands dispute is a little bit biased, I would say. I'm aware of that, and I haven't studied so, let's say, deep the possibility of self-determination. And
my question goes to Professor Wildmark, because I have the impression that when we talk about self-determination, we are talking it in a very narrow sense, in saying that, well, if the people of the Falklands would like to belong to the United Kingdom, but we are ending the discussion there. So if we could surmount of all of Professor Cohen's objections, shouldn't the discussion of self-determination should be broader? Even could we discussing about the possibility of an independent population of the Falkland Islands? Why is it just that self-determination must mean, as it was in the referendum of 2013, whether the people want to belong or not to the UK, and that's we end the discussion there, which could be the possible outcomes of broadening the discussion. Thank you.
There's an additional question.
I know, it's just to interject there. It's the question wasn't, do you want to remain in the UK? Do you want to change your status? Do you want to change your status?
To be independent.
Well, my question is, if we are talking about self-determination, why can't we just talk in the full sense of self-determination, not just if they want to belong to the UK and we end the discussion there?
Okay.
Yeah. So the right of self-determination, also expressed in the decolonization declaration, which Marcelo projected earlier. So in principle, there are three options in colonialism, not outside of colonialism. So that you opt for independence, that you continue as a territory of the state that under whose colonial rule you are or have been, and thirdly that you merge with another state, and which means that you do not necessarily need to, so that you're not forced to opt for independence if you don't want it, and the Falklanders actually never expressed any desire to become an independent state. So we don't have this then third element into the dispute. So what if they want to become independent, because yeah, international does not force them to consider that option. But then if I may ask a counter question. So what would be what also with what Hildegard said at the beginning? So if there is a Maastricht solution, so what would be a just solution? So would it be actually a just solution to transfer the islands together with the population back to Argentina? Or what would be a just solution in such a circumstance?
Any comments on your part, Marcel?
If you wish, yes. So in my view, the problem is not what was the question raised in 2013, but the very fact of the referendum itself, which did not solve the issue, for the simple reason that self-determination is not applicable in this context. So it was not a referendum organized by the United Nations, it was not a referendum supervised by the United Nations, etc., etc., etc. There were cases in which referenda were organized and were even condemned by the international community, or even in the context of decolonization, the solutions were different from that of consulting the inhabitants concerned. People in English have, you can use people in different ways. We are the people here, the people listening to me, etc., etc. But when I speak about people here, I'm speaking in the legal sense of holder of the right to self-determination. So the question is not whether you can ask about independence, integration, etc., etc. It's not. And I would like to stress one question, which is coherency. As I said that in my intervention earlier, coherency, because if you take the position of the United Kingdom with regard to Crimea, so there was a referendum in Crimea. One can criticize the way and the manner and the context in which it was organized. But assuming that the referendum was organized in a very objective manner, independent manner, in which people could have expressed their views, campaigning for yes, campaigning for no, etc., etc., assuming that even now the United Kingdom is condemning what it considered to be a Russian and illegal annexation of Crimea because it is in breach of the territorial integrity of Ukraine. So the United Kingdom is not claiming hold a referendum, a true one with international observers, etc., etc., etc. It's a matter of coherence, and I don't see any coherence here.
Thank you very much. Well, ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, we are coming to the close of the first panel during this seminar, and speaking for myself, but undoubtedly also for others, especially for those who have not studied the Falklands, Malvinas conflict in any sort of detail, I must express my great appreciation and gratitude to both speakers for giving us such a detailed, critical survey of the competing claims to sovereignty in the context of this particular dispute. It shows, I think, undoubtedly, how difficult it will be to solve the conflict. And for that reason, I do hope that our discussions this morning and our discussions this afternoon will shed further light on the possibilities of moving forward, of trying to assist in finding solutions, just solutions to this particular problem, as was called upon to us by the Dean of the Faculty. I would like to thank, dear colleagues, friends, on your behalf, the two speakers of this morning for their presentations, which helped so much us in understanding the problems relating to the titles to sovereignty to the Malvinas, Falklands, Islands. Thank you very much, and a big applause.